So, trace lines are basically a way of detecting any obstacles between two points, and these two points are connected with a line. Hence the name trace lines, right? And obstacles in this context can be anything from map geometry to entity bounding boxes to hitboxes. And they're basically used for collision detection, visibility, hit scans for weapons, and a bunch of other stuff. Now, to actually perform a trace line, you use this utility function, utilTraceLine. And here are its parameters. So vec start and vec end define the two points, which will be the line which is going to be traced along. And igmon simply controls whether the trace will detect or ignore monsters along the way. Now, pentignore is the entity that will be ignored, and that's typically the entity which we're tracing from. For example, when a player is shooting, the line would start at the player's origin, ending wherever the player's looking at. I'll explain this soon. And finally, PTR or putter or pointer takes a pointer to some trace result and fills it with a bunch of data and stuff. If we take a look at trace result, the structure itself that is, we see there are quite a few variables in it. There's lots of stuff to look at here, so let's just take a look at the most important variables. Fstart solid indicates whether the starting point was in the solid volume, for example inside some entity or in a brush. FL fraction is the fraction of the distance traveled and the total distance. So if the travel distance is 512 units, that is the length between point A and point B, and the trace hits an obstacle at 384 units, then the fraction is 0.75. Vec and pause is obviously the position where this hit occurred, and vec plane normal is a potentially quite useful variable which tells you the surface normal of whatever the trace managed to hit. P hit is the entity which was hit by the trace. And finally, iHitGroup, which is only applicable to entities with studio models by the way, tells us which hitbox group was hit. It is useful to determine whether we're gonna deal 3 times more damage because we hit something in the head or not, and so on. Now here's a bit of an example. Let's say we're in this map and we got these two players here, and as you can see there's this kind of wall between them. Let's also say that we're tracing from A to B, right? So the starting position is going to be player A's origin and the ending position player B's origin. And we're going to call utilTraceLine like so. And nothing happens actually. Normally you would expect that the trace line would end at the wall, but actually the trace result's ending position is the same as the starting position. So it appears as though it got stuck in the player's bounding box. And guess why? This is because we didn't pass an entity to ignore. Pentignore, as you can see, is null pointer. So we want to ignore the entity we start from so we don't get stuck in it. And that's pretty simple to add. And let's do something with this now. Let's write the jankiest camera ever. Usually, such an entity would use a model, but since probably most of you aren't modelers, we're gonna make it a brush entity instead. So let's assume this is single player only, so the camera is already gonna know where the player is located. The camera is gonna basically trace a line between itself and the player. So if it hits the player, it could, I don't know, trigger its target or something. In our test map, we're gonna set it up so it triggers an alarm. To keep things super simple, we're not gonna use save or store or any custom key values, though you probably should use save or store. In spawn, we're gonna set up a brush entity as usual and then let it think after a second and a half. This is because it takes a bit of time for the player to actually connect and then spawn in the server, and we don't want, you know, the camera to check for the player when the player doesn't actually exist. Anyway, in Think, we're gonna find out where the player's at. I mean, this information already exists, we're just gonna grab it. Then we're gonna trace between the camera and the player, and if the player is seen, we're gonna trigger the targets and make sure we don't trigger them again. Now, the only thing that's really missing is the camera's rotation. If we compile this straight away, the camera would just kinda sit there. We can do this by simply changing the yaw or introducing angular velocity if you remember the video about entity properties. But for now, we're just gonna change the yaw directly. And that should be about it. Now you just gotta write the FGD. Now, a certain viewer requested this, so here we go. Shout out to you, buddy. So this person here makes some Counter-Strike maps and stuff, so if you're into that, check him out. Now, in the next video, we're gonna do some vector maths. It's gonna be nothing scary, even if you're really bad at math. Like, the worst thing that can probably happen is the dot product or the cross product. And even that is pretty easy. In fact, we've already used one little utility function to calculate yaw from a direction vector. And there's gonna be more word about it in the next video. And until then, happy programming!